Dear students, welcome to the next online session of Aravai Maruthuvam. In the previous class, we have discussed about burns. The extent and depth of burns, the assessment and management of burns are all discussed in the previous class. You know, the burn injuries, they may cause oozing out of plasma fluid or any injury to the blood vessel due to the burns may also cause direct bleeding. Both these conditions may lead to hypovolemia. That hypovolemic shock is compensated by our body mechanism are also briefly discussed in the previous class. See, the severe hemorrhage, how it affects our body and how our body mechanisms are tackling this situation are going to be discussed in today's class. Let us discuss in detail on hemorrhage and its manifestations. I invite you to listen this session carefully to start up with definition. The definition for hemorrhage is abnormal and excessive bleeding. The classification of hemorrhage can be depending on nature of the vessel involved. Number 2, depending on the timing of hemorrhage. Number 3, depending on the duration of hemorrhage. Number 4, depending on the nature of bleeding. Let us discuss one by one. Depending on the nature of the vessels involved. The vessel, it could be an artery, vein or capillary. The arterial hemorrhage will be bright red in color, jets out blood due to the pumping effect of heart. If you palpate the location, pulsation of an artery can be felt. It can be controlled easily as it is visible. In case of venous hemorrhage, the bleeding will be dark red in color. It never jets out but oozes out. It is non-pulsatile and difficult to control because vein gets retracted. The capillary hemorrhage will be red in color, never jets out but slowly oozes out. Second one, depending on the timing of hemorrhage, it could be subdivided as primary hemorrhage, reactionary hemorrhage and secondary hemorrhage. The primary hemorrhage occurs at the time of surgery. The reactionary hemorrhage occurs after 6 to 12 hours of surgery. Hypertension in the post-operative period, violent sneezing, coughing or retching are the usual causes. In case of secondary hemorrhage, it occurs after 5 to 7 days of surgery. It is due to infection, which digests away the suture material, causing sloughing of vessel wall. Example, bleeding after 5 to 7 days of surgery for hemorrhoids. Third one, depending on the duration of hemorrhage, it could be acute and chronic hemorrhage. Acute hemorrhage occurs suddenly. Example, esophageal varicose bleeding due to portal hypertension. Whereas chronic hemorrhage occurs over a period of time. Example, chronic duodenal ulcer or hemorrhoids. Fourth one, depending on nature of bleeding, it could be external or internal hemorrhage. External hemorrhage is revealed hemorrhage. Example, epistaxis, hematemesis. Internal hemorrhage is concealed hemorrhage. Example, splenic rupture following an injury or ruptured ectopic gestation. Next, coming to the pathophysiology of hemorrhagic shock. A loss of more than 30-40% blood volume results in a fall in blood pressure and gross hypoperfusion of tissues and vital organs, which in turn results in decreased venous return to heart, thereby decreased cardiac output. It leads to manifestation of shock. The evolution of hemorrhagic shock can be classified into 4 stages. They are: stage 1 or mild hemorrhage shock, loss of less than 750 ml of blood or less than 15% of total blood volume happens. And stage 2 is a moderate shock, loss of 800 ml to 2500 ml of blood or 15-30% of total blood volume is lost. Stage 3 is considered as severe shock, a loss of 1500 ml to 2000 ml of blood or 30-40% of total blood volume is lost. Stage 4 is a very severe shock, a loss of more than 2000 ml of blood or more than 40% of total blood volume. See, let us discuss one after another. Stage 1 or mild hemorrhagic shock. If blood loss is less than 750 ml or less than 15% of total blood volume is lost, it may be called as mild hemorrhagic shock. Already 60-70% of blood volume is present in the low pressure venous system. 10% of blood volume is present in the splanchnic circulation as a compensatory mechanism during blood loss. Peripheral venoconstriction takes place, therefore shifting of some volume of blood into central circulation. At the same time, correction of blood volume also occurs due to withdrawal of fluid from interstitial compartment to intervascular compartment. Clinically, apart from a mild tachycardia and thirst, no other symptom or sign suggesting hypovolemia will happen. The BP, urinary output, and mental status are all normal in this stage 1 mild hemorrhagic shock. As of most of you know, if any one of you donated blood of 1 pint, if the 1 pint of blood is considered as 450 ml, if you donate 1 pint of blood, most of you might have experienced this kind of mild tachycardia and thirst, and except this, no other symptoms or signs will be developed in this mild or stage 1 type of shock. Stage 2, a loss of 800 ml to 1500 ml of blood or 15-30% of blood volume is lost, results in moderate shock. Peripheral venoconstriction alone may not be sufficient to maintain circulation. Hence, vasoactive hormones coming into action. The blood loss initially causes decreased blood flow to kidneys. This induces renin angiotensin mechanism. As you know, renin is secreted from juxtaglomerular apparatus and entered into circulation. This renin liberates angiotensin 1 from liver, which is converted to angiotensin 2 by the lungs. It selectively constricts the vasculature of splanchnic organs and skin. Another hormone, vasopressin or antidiuretic hormone, is released due to stimulus from baroreceptors such as those situated in carotid bodies and arch aorta, caused by hypotension. Vasopressin acts as a systemic vasoconstrictor, thus diverting blood to brain and heart and increases cardiac output. It also enhances blood volume by causing retention of water and salt. Release of vasoactive hormones usually takes place after 1 to 2 minutes of hemorrhage. Clinically, in stage 2 type of shock, the heart rate of the patient will be 100 to 120 beats per minute. Diastolic pressure will be elevated, urine output reduced to 0.5 ml per kg per hour. On examination, extremities may look pale. Patient is confused and increased thirst will be seen. And on stage 3, as we discussed earlier, LS of 1500 ml to 2000 ml or 30-40% of total blood volume produces stage 3 or severe shock. All the signs and symptoms in stage 2 worsens. Hence, adrenaline and noradrenaline, the catecholamines released from sympathoadrenal system, cause powerful vasoconstriction of both arteries and veins. Epinephrine secreted from adrenal medulla as a consequence of discharge of adrenergic effect of nervous system. Due to adrenergic discharge, arterioles, pre and post capillary sphincters, venules, vessels of skin, splanchnic organs and the skeletal muscles constrict altogether. Clinically, signs and symptoms worse than stage 2. Systolic and diastolic BP falls, heart rate increases to 120 beats per minute, pulse is thready, respiratory rate increases to 20 per minute, urine output drops to 10 to 20 ml per hour, patient appears pale and aggressive, drowsy or confused. You please note, the heart rate increases to 120 beats per minute and blood pressure is falling down. In some cases it is unrecordable. And these are very important points to remember or to understand the stage 3 or severe hemorrhagic shock. Stage 4, a loss of more than 2000 ml or more than 40% of loss of total blood volume, which causes a very severe hemorrhagic shock. All compensatory mechanisms such as vasoconstriction, effects of vasoactive hormones and adrenergic effect will into force. Renal shutdown by the effect of antidiuretic hormone or vasopressin and aldosterone takes place. Release of cortisol from adrenal cortex and glucagon from pancreas and the inhibition of release of insulin all lead to high extracellular glucose concentration. Products of anaerobic metabolism also accumulate in the extracellular space. Both these cause hyperosmolarity of the extracellular tissue, which draws water out of the cells. interstitial pressure increases, which forces water, sodium and chloride across the capillary endothelium into vascular space. Adrenocorticotropic hormone is released by any stress, including shock. This hormone and angiotensin II stimulate the synthesis and release of aldosterone from adrenal cortex. Aldosterone is concerned with resorption of sodium from glomerular ultrafiltrate into vascular space. Resorption of sodium and water by the kidneys helps to maintain the vascular volume. Clinically, pulse rate goes more than 120 per minute. Blood pressure is very low or unrecordable. If the condition persists, can damage other organs. Example, mucosal ulcerations, upper gastrointestinal bleeding, absorption of bacteria and toxins. Bacterial relocation and bacteremia can occur. Results with reduced clearance of toxins in the liver, acute renal failure, myocardial ischemia may also develop. Finally, multi-organ failure consequent to hemorrhagic shock is associated with a high mortality rate. Early diagnosis of bleeding and appropriate management is crucial to improve survival and outcome. Next, let's discuss about management of hemorrhagic shock. A patient in hemorrhagic shock needs immediate resuscitation to prevent or minimize damage to the vital organs and tissues. Resuscitation and control of hemorrhage should happen simultaneously. Therefore, the management for descriptive convenience is divided into two parts, as general measures and specific measures. Under general measures, let's discuss in detail about resuscitation, whereas under specific measures which are pertaining to control hemorrhage. As a part of general measures, as first aid, to save the patient of hemorrhagic shock, two principles should be followed. The first one is OMIV for all critically ill patients. O is meant for oxygen, M is meant for attach a monitor, IV for intravenous fluid administration. For easy memorizing, these short forms are given. First, provide oxygen administration by face mask to the patients who are in shock but are conscious and are able to maintain their airway. If unconscious, endotracheal intubation and ventilation with oxygen may be necessary. Then attach a monitor to record vital signs such as heart rate, blood pressure, respiratory rate and oxygen saturation. Then obtain two large bore intravenous access. Blood sample for investigations, blood grouping and cross matching should be sent at this stage. For initial resuscitation, preferably at 40 to 42 degrees centigrade, crystalloids such as saline, Ringer lactate or plasmolite to be infused quickly to restore the circulatory volume. Dextrose containing solutions are not recommended initially. Infusion of large amounts of isotonic saline can also cause hyperchloremic acidosis, and it is not recommended initially. The second principle is A, B, C. A for maintaining airway, B for breathing, C for circulation. During first aid, before providing oxygen, it is essential to check the airway, the nose, throat and the mouth. If any obstruction is revealed, it should be removed. If patient is unconscious, endotracheal intubation is necessary. Then assess the type of breathing. If it is abdominothoracic or thoracoabdominal, type of breathing is going on, it is normal. If not, and affected with altered type of breathing pattern like Kainstrom's breathing, Kussmaul's respiration, tachypnea, they should be addressed properly. Then assess pulse rate and volume, dryness of tongue, cold and pale extremities, vertigo. Assess the orientation of the patient to rule out confused or comatose conditions. They give clue to assess the existing circulatory status of the patient. Thereafter, resuscitation measures can be taken care of. Once the treatment is going on, we should monitor the improvements by assessing the progress in vital signs. If infusion up to 2 liters of Ringer lactate has not been successful in returning vital signs to normal, it is to be ascertained that the patient may be having ongoing bleeding. Such patients require transfusion of blood products such as packed cells and fresh frozen plasma. In an actively bleeding patient and who is also in hypovolemic shock, the ratio of packed cells, fresh frozen plasma, platelets would be 1:1:1. If shock is severe and the patient is in stage 4 shock, O negative blood can be given to save life. Subsequently, cross matching will need to be done before transfusing specific group of blood. All through the resuscitation activities, it is important to maintain the patient warm. Hypothermia impairs coagulation, increases bleeding, depresses respiration and circulation, as well as increases chances of infection. In cases where hemostasis is not yet achieved, volume infusion should be controlled to maintain systolic blood pressure at 80 to 90 millimeter of mercury till bleeding is stopped. This is called hypotensive fluid resuscitation or permissive hypotension. See, this is very important point in clinical practice. If the bleeding is not stopped or not arrested, until such time we are treating the patient with intravenous fluid infusion, we should maintain the systolic blood pressure only between 80 to 90 millimeter of mercury. If we infuse more quantity of fluid, the BP will increase. If BP increases, bleeding will be continuously going up, but it will coarsely affect the status of the patient. Therefore, until arresting the bleeding, the BP should be maintained within this 80 to 90 millimeter of mercury range. Once bleeding is controlled, infuse volume to allow blood pressure to reach normal level as soon as possible. Then second phase of resuscitation involves continuation of fluid therapy to ensure base deficit is eliminated. This is important to ensure that the microcirculation is normal. This should happen within 12 to 24 hours. Next, coming to specific measures to be adopted parallelly. Aimed to control hemorrhage and revive circulation. The following 4 points should be noted. They are to control hemorrhage, position and rest of the patient, applying tourniquets, surgical methods. The first point, in order to control hemorrhage, pressure and packing is the method of choice to stop bleeding. When bleeding site is accessible, first apply pressure locally proximal to the site of bleeding. Then use packings like roller gas with or without adrenaline to control bleeding. The best suitable example is to arrest the nasal bleeding. You can firmly hold the root of the nose by applying pressure proximal to the site of bleeding for some minutes. With this pressure effect itself, the bleeding will get arrested. If it is not arrested, you can use the packings of roller gas, either associated with adrenaline or without adrenaline. The packings can be inserted into the nose and firmly hold upon. It will arrest the bleeding from the nose. Number 2, position and rest. Elevation of leg controls bleeding from varicose veins. Keeping the patient in inclined bell's position, it means head low and leg raised position given in the picture, will enhance blood flow to brain, heart and lungs. If necessary to reduce the anxiety of the patient, sedation may be given intravenously. Third one, application of tourniquets. It is an application of tight bandage by using pneumatic cuffs with pressure gauge or using rubber bandages to mechanically compress the vessel to arrest bleeding. It may also be used in reduction of fractures, repair of tendons, repair of nerves, or when bloodless field is essential during surgery. While using it, too tight bandaging may cause arterial thrombosis and may result in gangrene. Too loose application will not serve the purpose. It is important that too long continuous application will also cause gangrene of the limb. Hence, it should be used with intermittent relaxation. Careful examination or history taking is also essential to rule out whether the patient is already having any peripheral vascular disease. Usual complications are ischemia, gangrene, and tourniquet nerve palsy. The fourth important one is surgical methods to control bleeding. They are application of artery forceps to control bleeding from veins, arteries, and capillaries. Application of ligatures for bleeding vessels. Cauterizing the bleeding point. Silver clips are used to control bleeding from cerebral vessels. Surgical procedure may be required to control bleeding. Example, splenectomy for splenic rupture, hysterectomy for uncontrollable postpartum hemorrhage. With these words, I conclude this session. I hope You are all sensitized with these features of hemorrhage and how it is classified into various classes and what are all the compensatory mechanisms are coming into place and what are all the suitable measures to tackle the hemorrhage. I hope it will be useful for you, and I request all of you to refer the concerned textbook. See you once again. Thank you.